Shalom Avarim, welcome friends in Hebrew. My name is Tony Pino, and today I would like to have a discussion concerning the terminology of covenant and testament. Oftentimes, within our discussions amongst people in the kingdom, we use the terminology Old Covenant, New Covenant, Old Testament, New Testament interchangeably, as if they are the exact same meaning. But we are going to find today that there is a difference between covenant and testament. Now, this discussion does not concern whether someone is in or out of the kingdom, but it does help give clarification what a covenant is versus a testament, so that when you're reading the scriptures, you can have a better understanding of what, especially what Shaul is saying within his letters. And I believe that to be very important as we're trying to rightly divide the word of truth. So as we are about to begin here, we want to start out with the blessing of salvation. We want to give all praise and glory and honor to Yeshua HaMashiach, our Messiah, our Lord, our King, for he's the only way to the Father, and he gives eternal life. So if you know this blessing, go ahead and join in. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech haolam, asher natan lanu et derech ha-Yeshua ba-Mashiach, Yeshua Baruch Hu. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has made the way of salvation through the Messiah Yeshua, blessed be his name. Amen. So as we begin, we want to go ahead and define the terms being used here so that that will help with clarity as we look to the scriptures. Now, with the word covenant in Hebrew, we see it is the word brit. And brit is defined as the cutting of something. So in the Tanakh, when you see the word Brit being used, it will translate into the word of cutting or covenant. And so it is always related in that way because of how a covenant is defined. Now, a covenant is defined with four main points. Within ancient times of Abraham and Moshe and Yeshua, this was well known, okay, but it's not so much well known here in the 20th century. There are four main points that need to be done and understood for a covenant to be considered valid. Number one is a proposal is being done between the parties that are involved. All right, and so with this proposal, one will be able to recognize whether it is an unconditional covenant or a conditional covenant. A conditional covenant means that both parties have responsibilities. Whatever the conditions have been agreed upon within the proposal, this type of agreement means that Party A has responsibilities to fulfill, and Party B has responsibilities to fulfill. Okay, that is a conditional covenant. In an unconditional covenant, both parties are involved, the proposal is being made, but Party A is making promises to Party B. Party B just stands back and receives the promises. He doesn't have any responsibilities, in other words. So Party A is taking on all responsibility of fulfilling the covenant. That is called an unconditional covenant. That means one person is responsible and only that one person. Okay? So once these proposals are being made and the decision is being done, unconditional or conditional covenant, both parties will then step into step two, which is they agree. There's an agreement on the proposal. That's step two. Okay? Once that has been done, then there needs to be blood ratification. All right, blood is sprinkled on the covenant, or the people pass through blood that are entering into the covenant, or the one that's being responsible for the covenant. And so it needs to be blood ratified. All right, and I'm going to show you some examples of that in scripture. But blood is always involved. And then the final point, point four, is there's a covenant meal. So a covenant meal is being done, and again, I'll show you that in scripture. But all four must be done in order for a covenant to be ratified and considered valid. This is very different from a testament, okay? Within the Greek culture, this is where we get the term diatheke, the Greek word diatheke for last will and testament, a testament, all right? Within the Greek culture and Greek society, your last will and testament, while you're alive, you can change it. You can leave however you want of your inheritance to whoever you want. It's very much like in America, your last will and testament. As long as you're alive, you can leave your inheritance to whoever, and you can change it, add to it, subtract to it while you're alive. This is very different than a covenant. Once the proposal has been ratified and agreed upon, and the blood has entered in and the covenant meal has been entered in, nothing can be added or taken away from a covenant. Okay? And the rabbis and the time of the first century and earlier all knew this. This is very common back then. And this is why in the Torah, you see that inheritance laws are given within the Torah. So if you were to go to Bamidbar, the book of Numbers, chapter 27, verses 5 through 11, Adonai gives a description of what a last will and testament is. That's the inheritance laws. Okay? And so that is a law. It can't be changed. All right? So the rabbis would allow a person to, as long as they're alive, to make changes within their inheritance, within the Jewish community, as long as it never violated the Torah. Okay, they would always look to the Torah, and if you made changes that violated the Torah, of course your changes would become nullified. And so the inheritance laws are already set in the Torah. It's not like the Greek culture, very different. Okay, and as you can begin to see, there is a difference between a testament in the Hebrew mind and a covenant. Okay, so now what we want to do is go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. Now before we begin, just to give some note, in Jewish society, the rabbis had strict rules regarding inheritance laws. An entire tractate of the Talmud, Bava Batra, or Batra, deals with the inheritance laws. In the Mishnah, Hebrew of the Talmud, the rabbis referred to a person's last will and testament as a diatheke, obviously a loan word from the Greek, meaning exactly the same thing. All right. The Talmud tractate, Bava Batra, explains the rules. A person's diatheke cannot contradict the Torah's inheritance laws. For example, if a man has a son and daughter and he wants to split the inheritance between them and says so in his diatheke, the rabbis declare the document invalid because it contradicts the Torah law that only a son inherit. Likewise, if a man wants to give a double portion to a different son than his firstborn and he says so in his diatheke, the rabbis declare the document invalid. Okay? And so there is What I am trying to show you is that the rabbis understood very clearly there's a difference between a last will and testament and a covenant. Okay? Now, in Galatians chapter 3, we see Shaul is speaking, right? Now he's going to be using human terms. This is very common in rabbinic, a rabbinic way of teaching. When you're trying to teach a spiritual principle or an abstract principle, a spiritual application, you use human terms, okay? Yeshua did parables, and within his parables, he's using a common Hebraic way of speaking, telling a story, and within that story, they would fully understand the spiritual meaning behind that story. So he's using human terms to speak about a covenant here in Galatians chapter 3. So in Galatians chapter 3, starting with verse 15. Brothers and sisters, I speak in human terms, even with a man's covenant. In the Greek, though, it says diatheke. Once it has been confirmed, no one cancels it or adds to it. He's fully following the Hebraic mindset of what a covenant is, okay? It can't be added to or canceled once it has been ratified, once those four steps have come into play. Okay? Now, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. It doesn't say unto seeds as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is the Mashiach, the Messiah. So, right here, Shaul is talking about the Abrahamic covenant. All right, the Abrahamic covenant is an unconditional covenant. All right, so let's go ahead and go real quickly and talk about this covenant. Let's go to Bereshit chapter 12. Bereshit, Genesis chapter 12. Verse 1. Then Adonai said to Abram, get going out from your land and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land that I will show you. My heart's desire is to make you into a great nation, to bless you, to make your name great, so as you may be a blessing. My desire is to bless those who bless you, but whoever curses you, I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. So in Avram, in his seed, through his seed, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Amen. Now, Avram is right here living as a pagan. He's living in idolatry. His father's house. This is why Adonai needs to get him away from his family. This is a huge decision by Avram, because in that culture, you don't leave your father's house without his permission. You lose your inheritance. You lose your connection. You lose your religion. You know, you lose everything connected to your family. But Adonai has to do this in order to accomplish his will through Avram, because Avram's going to have to only worship him and be solely dedicated to him. And Avram is used to worshiping many gods and being in idolatry. And in Judaism, there is a belief that Avram's father was an idol maker. Okay, there is a tradition in that. But we do know that he was definitely steeped in idolatry. That was in that land where he's being pulled out of. And so what is he actually being done is he's being saved by grace. Though he is still in his sin, he's being asked to take a step of faith and come out and follow Adonai and only Adonai, despite what anything else or anyone else might say. And Avram does this. He does this act of faith. All right. Notice that faith was not just something mental. It's not just something, oh, yeah, I believe your promise, Adonai, but I'm going to stay here and you're still going to give me my promise. I'm not going to do any action. No, he had to leave. All right. Part of his faith and belief was him leaving, putting that into action. And Adonai honored that as righteous. Okay. It would not have been righteous if he would have stayed there. So salvation by grace is, we're seeing the pattern right here, by faith. It wasn't any type of work that Avram did to deserve it, okay? The proposal is being made by Adonai, what he's going to do, and Abraham needs to lead by faith. So that's what he does. So he enters into a salvation relationship. Salvation in Hebraic terms is a relationship, a covenant relationship with Adonai. That is salvation. You're coming out of the world and its ways, and you're entering into solely worshiping Adonai, okay? So he's going to be entering into this covenant. We do see this again in Genesis chapter 15. Okay, starting with verse 1. After these things, the word of Adonai came to Avram in a vision, saying, do not fear, Avram. I am your shield, your very great reward. There's this entering into this relationship now. And so he's being rewarded. Okay, Adonai is going to be his reward. He now has this salvation relationship with Adonai. But Avram said to my Lord in verse 2, what will you give me since I am living without children and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus? Then Avram said, look, you have given me no seed, so a house-born servant is my heir. Then behold, the word of Adonai came to him saying, this one will not be your heir, but in fact, one who will come from your body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up now at the sky and count the stars if you are able to count them. Then he said to them, so shall your seed be. His seed. He's talking about his physical seed. A promise is being made by Adonai about the physical seed, the promise that is being made that will come through Avram to the nations, all the earth will be blessed, will come through a physical seed of his. Okay? We see this in, notice in Galatians, that's what Shaul is bringing forth. We're talking about this covenant now. Okay? So, verse 6, then he believed in Adonai and he reckoned it to him as righteousness. Amen. So he put his faith and trust in what Adonai is saying. Now this is going to come forth with action. Then he said to him, I am Adonai who brought you out from Ur of the Chaldeans in order to give you this land to inherit it. I brought you out of idolatry. I brought you out of a people of wickedness that don't follow my ways. And I, because of your faith and trust in me, I'm going to be giving you this land as your inheritance. Not to mention the land of a promised seed that would come through him. So he said, my Lord Adonai, how will I know that I will inherit it? Then he said to him, bring me a three-year-old young cow, a three-year-old she-goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young bird. So he names off these animals because he's given the proposal. All right, now Avram wants to agree to the proposal. So how will I know? Well, we're going to enter into this covenant. So he tells him what animals to bring. He already knows this is a blood covenant. He knows exactly what Adonai is asking of him. Avram goes and gets it. He does exactly what a covenant would be. Adonai doesn't even have to tell Avram how to do it. He cuts them in half. Verse 10, so he brought all these to him and cut them in half and put each piece opposite the other. But he did not cut the birds. Then the birds of prey came down upon the carcasses, but Avram drove them away. Then the sun was about to set, and a deep sleep fell on Avram. Behold, terror of great darkness was falling upon him. Then he said to Avram, know for certain that your seed will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and they will be enslaved and oppressed 400 years. But I am going to judge the nation that they will serve. Afterwards, they will go out with many possessions. But you will come to your fathers in peace. You will be buried at a good old age. Then in the fourth generation, they will return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. When the sun set and it became dark, behold, there was a smoking oven and a fiery torch that passed between these pieces. On that day, Adonai cut a covenant with Avram, saying, I will give this land to your seed from the river of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates River. So as you can see, Avram never stepped into the blood. Only the smoking oven and the fiery torch. Now, the common belief is this was the father passing through, making this promise to them. But I also believe that Yeshua walked through it. My personal belief is Yeshua represents the fiery torch, for he is the light of the world, and the smoking oven represents the Father, that we see when he comes down on Mount Sinai as a pillar of smoke. And so that's just my belief. You can agree or disagree, but we do know that between Adonai and Avram, the covenant was made. And as we can see, this is an unconditional covenant. Avram has no promises that he needs to do. Doesn't matter about his actions, okay? It matters that Adonai made a promise to him, all right? And so this becomes sealed, all right? And we see in Bereshit, Genesis chapter 17, that the sign is going to be circumcision, that Adonai is going to do this great work for Avram. And so here we go in verse 1 of Bereshit, Genesis chapter 17. When Avram was 99 years old, Adonai appeared to Avram and he said to him, I am El Shaddai. Continually walk before me and you will be blameless. My heart's desire is to make my covenant between me and you, and then I will multiply you exceedingly much. Avram fell on his face and God spoke with him saying, for my part, because my covenant is with you, you will be the father of multitude of nations. No longer will your name be Avram, but your name will be Abraham, because I make you the father of a multitude of nations. Yes, I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings will come forth from you. Yes, I will establish my covenant between me and you and your seed after you throughout their generations. for an everlasting covenant, in order to be your God and to your seeds God after you. I will give to you and to your seed after you the land where you are an outsider, the whole land of Canaan, as an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. God also said to Abram, as for you, my covenant you must keep, you and your seed after you throughout their generations. This is my covenant that you will make, that you must keep between me and you and your seed after you. All your males must be circumcised. You must be circumcised in the flesh of your foreskin, and this will become a sign of the covenant between me and you. Also, your eight-year-olds must be circumcised, every male throughout your generations, including a house-born slave or a slave bought with money from any foreigner who is not of your seed. Your house-born slave and your purchased slave must surely be circumcised. So my covenant will be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant. Amen. So he is being proposed here the circumcision covenant, that as long as Abram circumcises all his males after 8 days, any of the newborns, people that are owned by him through the purchase of slavery must also be circumcised. This will be the sign of the covenant of everything that Adonai just said would happen for him. And Adonai would be the one doing all the keeping of the promise there. All Abram had to do was continually stay faithful to the gift of circumcision. And he does do that. Amen. And so all throughout time, they know that they must keep this. This covenant has been done. It has been ratified. And so this is something that must be continual. And Adonai continues to keep his promises. Amen. And so in fulfilling of the prophecy that was involved in this covenant, we now go to Exodus, Shemot, chapter 19. Okay. And so what is going on here is Adonai, in keeping with the promise of Abraham, has saved Israel out of the bondage of slavery, being held by Mitzrayim, by Egypt. He saves them by grace. All right. They have not been following his ways. They are slaves in Egypt. They are accustomed to worshiping the Egyptian gods. They've watched them all the years that they've been in slavery. And so they are not following Adonai's ways correctly. But Adonai is going to save them by grace because of his covenant with Abraham. He's got to stay faithful to that covenant. All right? It's a blood covenant that he walked through the blood, not Abraham. And so he owes Abraham this. And Abraham is going to receive this promise continually, even though he is dead. And so Adonai delivers them out of Mitzrayim by grace, following the same pattern as given to Abraham to be delivered out of his household by grace, the one that was in idolatry. And so now we come to Sinai in chapter 19 of Shemot. Adonai wants to enter into a second covenant, another covenant. It's a marriage covenant, okay? And so in chapter 19, you get this. You have to go ahead and read. He wants to make a nation of priests. Everybody's going to be a priest. All right, he wants to make a holy nation, a set-apart people, okay? So they agree upon the proposal. And where we see this agreement for this next covenant is in Exodus chapter 24. In Exodus chapter 24, Moshe, who has come down from the mountain after receiving the 10 debars and all the covenant laws that are going to be required in this covenant, he goes ahead, he comes down, he's only gotten it verbally, he explains it to the people, they agree. So what does Moshe do? Because once they agree to the proposal, the next step is it needs to be blood ratified. So he writes it all down on a scroll. And we see this in verse 7 of Shemot, Exodus 24. He took the scroll of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. Again, they said, all that Adonai has spoken, we will do and obey. And so he's got it written down. We're in step 3. We're getting the blood ratification going on here. Then Moshe took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, behold, the blood of the covenant, which Adonai has cut with you, in agreement with all these words. Then Moshe and Aaron and Nadab and Abihu and the 70 of the elders of Israel went up. They saw the God of Israel, and under his feet was something like a pavement of sapphire, as clear as the very heavens. Yet he did not raise his hand against the nobles of Bnei Israel. So they beheld God and ate and drank. They're sealing the covenant with the meal. This is the fourth and final step. And so they have this covenant relationship. It's a marriage covenant. It's not the same as the covenant Adonai made with Abram. These are two different covenants. One is unconditional. One is conditional. Okay? And as we can see, going back to Galatians chapter 3, verse 15 again, brothers and sisters, I speak in human terms. Even with a man's covenant, once it has been confirmed, no one cancels it or adds to it. Now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. It doesn't say, and seeds, as of many, but as of one, and to your seed, who is the Messiah, the Mashiach. So he's making a midrash. He's making a commentary on what happened in Genesis chapters 12 through 17. This is covenant cannot be added to or taken away. It's totally within rabbinic law and within the ancient times of those days. Though you have another covenant, it can't take away from the first. All right. And he's clarifying what this promise was being made, not to Abraham's seeds, but seed singular. And we see this, of course, being done because Abram had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. And so it came through what? One seed. The promise continually came through the one that Adonai chose, and it came through Yitzhak's seed. All right, and eventually it comes to Messiah, Mashiach. All right, it's coming through the one seed. The promise of the inheritance of all of this being done to all the families of the earth is being done here. All right, this doesn't nullify the ethnic Jew, because Yeshua is an ethnic Jew, so it still is to his seeds, but it's coming through Yeshua. All right, and it's coming through his work. So it's going to be the work of the seed of Messiah, Mashiach, that this is happening. Okay? Now, in verse 17 of Galatians 3, Shaul says this, what I am saying is this, Torah, which came 430 years later, does not cancel the covenant previously confirmed by God so as to make the promise in effect. In other words, the blessing and the inheritance and everything that's going to be given to Israel and all those who join in to her is not going to be determined by the Sinai covenant. It's going to be determined by the Abrahamic covenant. So that means it doesn't matter what Israel does, their actions, because Adonai made an unconditional covenant with Abram. He's got to fulfill it despite the actions of Israel. Okay? And as I have shared with you, within the Sinai covenant, it is a conditional covenant, okay? And so there was blessings and cursings given to Israel. If they fulfilled it, they received blessings. If they didn't fulfill it, they received cursings. And also, they could be scattered to the four corners of the earth, which has been done to them within that covenant. And within that covenant was the inheritance laws, the last will and testament laws. And so when it comes to a Hebrew understanding, we must keep it within that context of what a covenant is versus a testament. All right. Again, in Bab Midbar, Numbers chapter 27, verses 5 through 11, you see the testament, the last will and testament laws. We're talking about covenants right now. Okay. And so the covenant made at Sinai does not nullify the covenant made with Abraham. Okay? And the covenant made with Abraham was a total dependent, not on any work of man, for this promise and this blessing to come about, but it was going to be done by the grace of Adonai, because he was going to do the work. So entering into a covenant relationship with Adonai is always by grace. It's always by the work of Adonai. He did it with Abram, bringing him out of the pagan household that he belonged to. And then he did it again with Israel, bringing them out of the paganism of Mitzrayim, Egypt, bringing them, wanting them to be a set apart people, holy unto him. And so he makes that marriage covenant with them. Now, Israel breaks the covenant, okay, at Sinai. After Moshe ratifies the covenant, does the book of the covenant in chapter 24 of Shemot, all right, he goes up from that point up the mountain to receive the 10 Dabars so that they can be written on the tablets. All right, he only got them verbally up until then. Now he's got to go get them written on the tablets. So while he's up there receiving the tablets for 40 days and 40 nights, Israel breaks the covenant. They create the golden calf, and so he comes down. The covenant is broken. What's to do now? The nation needs to be destroyed. But wait a minute. If he destroys the nation, how will he complete the promise to Abraham that through him would come the blessing? All right, he would eliminate the seed of Abraham if he destroys the entire nation. So, in other words, to keep that covenant so that it can't be canceled or nullified, what does he do? He gives them what is called the Book of the Law. All right, and all that does is sustain the covenant relationship between Adonai and Israel. So what happens is when you go and you read about the golden calf incident, all right, starting in Exodus chapter 31, Shemot chapter 31, you begin to get the writing of the book of the law. And that is Adonai, at that point, everyone can't be a priest. He pulls out the tribe of Levi, sets them aside, and sets them apart. And through Aaron, who is a Levite, only his seed will the priesthood come from. So he creates a priesthood from the tribe of Levi, and the entire tribe of Levi is set apart. So if you're not from Aaron's line, you still will be working for Adonai and you're set apart, but you won't be a priest. Okay? So every Levite is not a priest, but every priest is a Levite. Okay? You got to come through the line of Aaron. Okay? Now, he does this. He adds all the sacrificial system laws to the book of the Torah. He adds other laws to it. And we see this when you study, again, Exodus chapter 31. You would study that all the way to Deuteronomy, Devarim, chapter 31, verse 26. This is all the giving of the book of the law. And as you can see, that in Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 26. We'll go ahead and go there real quickly. We'll start with verse 24. Now, when Moshe had finished writing the words of this Torah on a scroll, the book of the law, right to the end, Moshe commanded the Levites, carriers of the Ark of the Covenant of Adonai, saying, "Take this scroll of the Torah and place it beside the Ark of the Covenant of Adonai your God. It will remain there as a witness against you, for I know your rebellion and your stiff neck. Indeed, while I am still alive with you today, you will have been rebellious against Adonai, how much more than after my death?" So, see, Adonai, he's got to stay faithful to the promise of Abraham. He's got to bring forth the promise through the seed of Abraham. He's got to bring forth Mashiach through there. But he's got a problem. Israel is a stiff-necked people. They will not obey his Torah correctly in the manner of which he desires a perfect walk. A continual perfect walk. So he gives them the book of the Torah to maintain the relationship so that he can keep the seed alive. As long as there is blood being covered over their sins, Adonai can maintain the relationship. It all falls in the blood covenant, all right, of the marriage covenant. So he gives them the sacrificial system, he gives them other laws on how to govern while they are a society living in the land of Israel. And so this book of the Torah will lay outside the mercy seat because they are walking in a broken covenant. The covenant still is broken, okay, because of the golden calf incident. And so what the book of the Torah is doing, it's delaying the punishment deserved upon Israel because all of Israel would be annihilated. And so there is a delay. He can't nullify the covenant. He can't add to it. Okay? This is not adding to it. This is just postponing it until a proper payment can be made for the sin of what they had done. And so this is delaying it until Yeshua comes. All right? And so this is what we see in Jeremiah chapter 31. Let's go ahead and go there. In Jeremiah chapter 31. All right, start with verse 30. In some of your Bibles, it might be 31. Behold, days are coming, it is a declaration of Adonai, when I will make a Brit Hadashah, a new covenant, with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not like the covenant I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the land to bring them out of the land of Egypt. For they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them. It is a declaration of Adonai. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days. It is a declaration of Adonai. I will put my Torah, book of the law, within them. So it's not going to be something just written on a scroll. It's going to be written on their hearts. In other words, the power of the Ruach HaKodesh living inside of them will enable them to walk in the way that Adonai wanted them to walk. He will be able to take away that stiff-neckedness that they have. Okay? It says, yes, I will write it on their heart. I will be their God, and they will be my people. And so this, again, is a new covenant, Brit Hadashah, being made to Israel. It does not nullify the Abrahamic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant is a salvation by grace covenant. It's all by Adonai's work, that he's going to provide all of these promises that he made. It's always a salvation by grace in any of the covenants that have begun, because we see that with Abraham and we see that with Israel being delivered out of Mitzrayim. And so it will be the same with the Brit Hadashah, the new covenant. Yeshua comes, he lives a sinless life, he is the promised one. All right, he is the one that's going to fulfill the Abrahamic covenant, and he is the one that's going to fulfill the sacrificial system, pointing towards the payment that will be made for the sins of Israel at Sinai, so that they can enter into a Brit Hadashah, a new covenant, okay? And therefore, the payment for what happened at Sinai is being made and done. Not only the payment for that sin and those issues that were done at Sinai, but he's also reversing the sin of Adam, okay? It's all coming together in the Brit Hadashah. The Brit Hadashah is fulfilling the Abrahamic covenant, and then it is taking care of the Sinai covenant so that we enter into the Brit Hadashah, a new covenant, all right, where this blood, this sacrifice will allow every one of us to come in and become a kingdom of priests. And it's not just to the nation of Israel, but it is to all nations. The offer is to all nations. And so that's why you're bringing all the covenants together. But notice these are covenants and not last will and testament. Okay? This is all walking in line with the covenant. Now, let's go ahead and go back to Galatians chapter 3. If you know the historical context behind Galatians chapter 3, it is very important to understanding these verses. All right, because Shaul is writing a letter, not a theological essay, He's not trying to earn his PhD in Jewish theology. There is a specific situation going on in Galatians, okay? And he's addressing that situation using the scriptures. And so what has happened is ethnic pride has risen in Israel over the decades. And so they have developed a halakha, oral law, situation of how someone becomes a proselyte, okay, to Judaism. In other words, how do you enter into a covenant relationship with the God of Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov? How do you enter into it? You must convert to Judaism, okay? And they've developed this whole conversion proselytization laws during that time. And so you could not just enter as a non-ethnic Jew and become an equal citizen of Israel unless you went through their proselytization process, okay? Because you needed to be counted as an ethnic Jew, all right? And the only way a non-ethnic Jew could do that is to have that conversion, that proselytization process, where they become physically circumcised and they follow all the proselytization laws that the rabbis had created during that time. It is then and only then that you can be counted as an equal person within Israel. And what is being said here by Shaul is this breaks the Torah. The Torah never designed it to go this way. You designed it to go this way. And so we have proof by the work of the Ruach HaKodesh that someone does not enter into a covenant relationship with Adonai through physical circumcision. Nor do they have to be an ethnic Jew in order to enter that relationship. The proof is Abraham. He was not even considered a Hebrew or a Jew from the time he was living with his father in his father's house. And yet Adonai came to him and said, come out of your father's house and come with me. He did it by faith. And Adonai accepted him, though he was uncircumcised. Okay. In Egypt, when they left, in Shemot, Genesis chapter 12, verse 38, a multitude of people left with them. They were not forced to be circumcised in order to leave with them. When they got to Mount Sinai, they weren't forced to be circumcised in order to enter into that covenant relationship with them. They could dwell amongst them how they were. And you'll find that in Bab Midbar, Book of Numbers, chapter 15, there is one Torah for the native and the foreigner. One Torah. So the laws were set up so that both the non-ethnic Jew and the Jew could live together in harmony, and they would follow the one Torah, and that would make up the kingdom right there. And physical circumcision was not required to be involved in that covenant. All right. It was only the responsibility of the ethnic Jew to stay circumcised as the sign of the covenant for Abraham. Okay. It wasn't the responsibility of the non-ethnic Jew. Now, the non-ethnic Jew couldn't do certain things unless they were circumcised, but that did not mean they couldn't dwell amongst Israel and be counted as an equal and be judged according to the Torah equally to a native. If they were to go to court and all that, they would be judged equally, though an uncircumcised man would be standing there. And so this development in the first century that occurred, that you could not be an equal citizen in Israel or amongst the Jews unless you were a proselyte, was breaking Torah. And we see more proof of that at the house of Cornelius. Amen. When Peter went to Cornelius's house and the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, fell on them through their faith and trust in Yeshua, they were not circumcised. The Holy Spirit saved them, renewed them, filled them, though they were not circumcised. So right in front of Peter's face, he knows that they don't have to be circumcised to enter the kingdom. By the power of the Ruach HaKodesh, it's been shown to him. Now in Galatians chapter 1, let's go there. Starting with verse 6, I am amazed that you are so quickly turning away from the one who called you by the grace of Messiah. to a different good news. Not that there is another, but only some who are confusing you and want to distort the good news of Messiah. But even if we or an angel from heaven should announce any good news to you other than what you have proclaimed to you, let that person be accursed. As we have said before, so I now repeat, if anyone proclaims to you good news other than what you received, let that person be under a curse. I am now trying to win people's approval or God's. Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Messiah. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the good news proclaimed to me by me is not man-made. I did not receive it by any human, nor was I taught it, but it came through a revelation of Yeshua the Mashiach, the Messiah. This revelation that was given to Peter, that a person does not have to be physically circumcised to enter the kingdom, was given to Shaul by Yeshua himself. He received this revelation. It lines up with what happened with Peter in Acts chapter 10. And so this idea of not being physically circumcised to be counted equal in Messiah was something that was hidden because the waters had gotten muddy through all the halakha laws, the oral laws that the rabbis had surfaced. But you have to understand, Adonai goes according to the covenant. And so, and the way he set it up and designed it, doesn't matter how many traditions of men or oral laws that are created, Adonai follows the way he designed it. And so Shaul had to come out of this thinking because he was a Pharisee, a Parashim. And so he followed that way also, but now he's received the revelation of the truth, and so now that's what he's preaching. So he must oppose his fellow Parashim who are believers in Yeshua, but who are trying to hold to the fence laws created. And so they are trying to hold to forcing circumcision to enter the kingdom or enter the covenant. And this is what Shaul is against. And he says, I've been given this revelation. That's why in chapter 3, we're seeing the explanation being done. Verse 18, for if the inheritance is based on law, it is no longer based on a promise. There was a covenant given to Abraham of an inheritance. It's a covenant, not a last will and testament. Amen. It's a covenant. It was based on a promise, not any type of works of the law, not any type of physical circumcision, ceremonial work that the rabbis created. For if the inheritance is based on the law, it is no longer based on a promise. But God had graciously given it to Abraham by means of a promise. Then why the Torah? Why the law? It was added because of wrongdoings until the seed would come to whom the promise had been made. All right, so the Torah was given. It was added because they broke the Sinai covenant. It was added because of wrongdoings. The golden calf incident. Okay? It was added until the seed come. The seed what? The seed of promise. Yeshua HaMashiach. All right? So the sacrificial system was added until the seed come. Now Yeshua, blood sacrifice, pays for their sin that happened at Mount Sinai. So it pays it off. He can start a new Brit Hadashah covenant in his blood, which involves Israel, because that's who it's being made to. It wipes away what happened, all right? It pays the payment of the broken covenant at Sinai, all right? And it allows them to enter into the new covenant if they will take it by faith. And on top of that, it allows the promises made to Abraham to be fulfilled. So it's twofold going on. The blood of Yeshua does so many things. The blood of Yeshua gives a Brit Hadashah new covenant than the Sinai covenant, okay? It fulfills the promise to Abraham, and it's in the process of fulfilling that. And it also reverses the sin of Adam. It reverses the curse of death that is upon all creation. And so it's a multifaceted sacrifice that Yeshua does. He's fulfilling many things at one time. And so it's not that the Torah is done away with, because the Torah is the laws of the kingdom, all right? But it allows you to freely come in to this covenant relationship, all right? Remember, in Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34, the Torah is now being written on your heart by the power of the Ruach HaKodesh. So he doesn't do away with the Torah, because the Torah is the laws of the kingdom. You must read all the laws of the kingdom, okay? And so that is what it's doing. It's helping you to fulfill the laws of the kingdom. And it's only through his blood that you can do that. So this, all this is covenant language. This is not testament, last will and testament language. All right. Within Greek society, again, the word testament, diatheke, has to do with a last will and testament. And within that last will and testament, within that culture, you could change it as long as you are alive. As we just walked through everything we just talked about, with a covenant, you can't do that. You can't do that. And so when we are speaking of the Sinai covenant and the Brit Hadashah, the new covenant, it can bring confusion by using the word testament. In our culture, we think of a testament as a last will and testament, that things can be changed while you're alive. That's not the same definition as a covenant. And so it would be better clarification and be more correct to use the term covenant when you are speaking of the scriptures. Amen. And where a lot of this can be brought out, and it's written within the Talmud, okay? There's an entire tractate dedicated to inheritance laws on what would be a testament, inheritance laws. So the Talmud tractate, Bava Batra, explains the rules. A person's diatheke, last will and testament, cannot contradict the Torah's inheritance laws. That is found in Bav Midbar, Numbers chapter 27, verses 5 through 11. For example, if a man has a son and a daughter and he wants to split the inheritance between them and says so in his diatheke, the last will and testament, the rabbis declare the document invalid because it contradicts the Torah laws that only sons inherit. Likewise, if a man wants to give a double portion to a different son than his firstborn and he says so in his diatheke, last will and testament, the rabbis declare the document invalid. Okay? The inheritance laws, your last will and testament, must line up with the Torah within Jewish culture, within that era, okay, in that time. And so there is a constant difference. The rabbis know it. Yeshua knows it. That culture knows that there's a difference between covenant and testament. And so when we understand these things, we can rightly divide the word of truth. Amen. So I think this would be this was helpful. I hope it was helpful to you. And so I'm going to go ahead and end this time here. But I hope this will help you rightly divide the word of truth, that with clarity, it is much better to constantly be using the term covenant, using the term Sinai covenant and Brit Hadashah covenant, because the covenants are still valid right now. None of them have been done away with permanently yet. They're all in the process of being fulfilled. And there's nothing wrong with having multiple covenants at one time running side by side. You see that with the Noahic covenant. The Noahic covenant was given to Noah. And when Abraham was given a covenant, it didn't nullify the Noahic covenant. They're both were walking side by side with one another. When the Sinai covenant came along, it didn't nullify the Abrahamic covenant, nor the Noahic covenant, right? They all were ratified together, and they have separate meanings and separate purposes, and they are all walking side by side with one another. The Brit Hadashah, did not nullify any of those covenants. Okay? It paid the price for what is owed in some of those covenants, what is owed at the Sinai covenant, but it has not abolished it. Amen. And this is a Hebraic way of thinking. This is very hard in our Greek minds and our Greek culture to understand this. But within the Hebraic way of thinking, there is no tension. It's fully understood. All the covenants are walking side by side right now. They will be fully fulfilled after the white throne judgment, when Yeshua gives the final reward and the final proclamation of everything being fulfilled and done at the wedding feast and at the white throne judgment. It'll all be come together. All right. And then we will enter into the new heaven and the new earth, where there will be no death. All right. No more of death and tears and sorrow. All right. Everything will have been fulfilled and completed at that point. Amen. So again, I hope this was helpful to you. As we end our discussions, we always want to end with the Aaronic blessing, because we are Adonai's image bearers. And through the power and the work of Yeshua on the cross, we now have the Ruach HaKodesh living inside of us in the Brit Hadashah covenant, the new covenant, and we are his image bearers. And so the Aaronic blessing is just that. It is a blessing asking that Adonai's name be placed upon you, that you walk bearing his name. Amen. And so if you know this blessing, go ahead and join in with me. Yevarechecha Adonai ve'ish merecha. Ya'er Adonai pa'anav elecha ve'unecha. Yisa Adonai pa'anav elecha ve'aseh lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. Shalom, everyone.